seated. Well, good morning. I'd like to welcome each and every one of you to New Home this morning. Glad you decided to come out. David Cummins just told me, gave me an announcement. Doug Whitaker, this is the son of Hervey and Mary Whitaker. He passed away around 9 o'clock last night, so let's keep that family in our prayers this morning. If you take your bulletin, we'll be going through the announcements. The ball group has a trip planned for October the 11th. There's more details in the foyer and also a sign-up sheet. The candy for the trunk or treat and the box for Operation Christmas Child are out there in the front. Are you going to make announcements on those in a minute? Okay. Candy's going to come up here in a few minutes. Homecoming, don't forget, is October 12th. There's special music provided by Brian Free and Assurance, and there are still flyers out there in the back if you want to grab one or two. Also, keep in mind there's a potluck meal following the service that morning. Oh, and thanks for everybody who came out and participated in the softball tournament yesterday, and also the ones that came out there and watched. We had a good turnout. Had a couple people get hurt, but it was fun. Miss Candy, you want to come up?
Real quick about the ongoing projects of the Harvest Festival and Trunk or Treat and Operation Christmas Child, please continue to bring in candy. We plan on sugaring up as many children as we can get our hands on October 31st. Bring candy. Sign up. There are 4 pages of jobs I've got laid out there. They're fun jobs, but sign up. If we all work together, we can have something that's going to engage children and families for well over an hour of their time on Halloween night and give them a wonderful, positive alternative to icky, bad, yucky, not worldly things. And we can give them some seriously good, God-loving things while they're here. We have carnival games. We have hay rides. We have trunk or treat planned. We have a cakewalk. We've got all sorts of wonderful fun things planned. There's something for everybody to do. We have sit-down jobs. We have walking around jobs. We have talking jobs. We have pointing jobs. So if you don't like to talk to people in public, I can give you a flashlight and you can point. I can find something for you to do if you are willing to help out for our trunk or treat. So continue to bring candy for that. And for Operation Christmas Child, we will continue to take donations for that. If you're wondering what can go in the boxes, there are packing guides in the back. Nothing military related. It could be military related like camo, but it can't be army guys. It can't be guns of any kind, not even water guns. Because a lot of these boxes are going to children in places who've never seen anything but war their whole lives. They've never seen anything but scary military guys who are traumatizing them on a daily basis. So we don't want to send anything like that. But you can send hard candies as long as they are like peppermints. We can put those in goodie bags. But they all need hygiene items, soaps, washcloths, toothbrushes. Toothpaste is okay. There's no liquids, but toothpaste is a paste, so they let that one fly. So if you do soap, it needs to be bar soap. For the packing party, we're also going to need Ziploc bags, snack size and sandwich size, crayons, any kind of school supplies, go. And we can separate out crayons into Ziploc bags if we end up needing doing that. So just keep that in mind as you're out and about, or if you're cleaning out a closet, you know, and you got a youngin' in college and all of a sudden you see 6 packs of loose leaf paper, bring it to me. We can use it. Just keep in mind, if you have any questions, feel free to call me or call Trey and he can put you in touch with me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Candy. Brother Steve Haddock, would you lead us in opening prayer? Let's all stand. fellowship with one another.
Thank you. is good.
And all the time? Amen. He is. I was just informed that the tournament yesterday, if most of you don't know, it was a charity event meant to raise money for the Lane family, Kylie. And I was just informed that in concessions alone, they raised over $3,000 for that family. And they're playing again starting today at 1, correct? So continue to pray for that family and that benefit that's going on today. As our ushers come forward to take up our tithes and offerings, I'm going to ask Brother Joe Hearn if you would pray for our offering. Thank you.
I wish Kelly could have been here this morning to hear that song. She was talking about if you missed her testimony on Sunday, you missed a blessing. But she talked about going through storms. If you're going through storms, all you need is Jesus. He's there for you. He's the one who can calm the sea. He promises us that. So if you're going through a storm this morning, I encourage you, turn to Jesus. He'll get you through it.
Good morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today, isn't it? Amen. Today I would invite you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of Mark. Our scripture today will come from the book of Mark, the 12th chapter. Mark chapter 12, we will be reading only one verse today, but I'm sure that you are familiar with this passage. Mark 12, verse 31. And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. Would you pray with me? Father God, Lord, we thank you again for another day. Lord, for beautiful weather. Lord, for a beautiful place to come and to freely worship your name. May we give you thanks for these blessings. God, as we gather here today, I pray that we would come with a united focus and with a united purpose. Lord, I pray that we are gathered here today because we desire you. Lord, I pray that you would give us the strength to push aside all that the devil has placed upon us. All of the things he places in our minds to distract us from you. All of the things that he does to pull our attention away from you. I pray, dear Lord, for the next few moments we would be able to put those aside and that we would be able to give you the honor and the attention that you so richly deserve. Please, dear Lord, we pray that you would come now. Lord, that you would open your word to our hearts, that you would speak and that our minds would feel you and know you and we would understand your will and your purpose. Father God, come now. Please, dear Lord, may you speak through me. Bless our time with you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. I've let it go for a couple weeks, but I think I can pick back up on it now. I haven't told y'all a kayak story in a week or two. I see smirks out there. I want to tell you about the kayak trip, something I noticed. When I got back home Saturday night, I realized a few things. I realized I had packed some things on my trip that I did not need. I had a few things that I had absolutely no use for. You always got use for donuts, Oogie. That's just wrong right there. One of the things that I had that I didn't need is I had a dry blanket. You hear that, guys? I had something dry. That blanket did not do me any good. It would have kept me warm if I'd been in a tent, but I was in a hammock. And, you know, When you have about 20 inches of rain in 5 minutes, it doesn't matter if you're in a hammock. That blanket did me no good. But not only that, I had a dry pair of socks. I honestly don't know what I was thinking when I packed a pair of socks for this trip, because I didn't even have shoes on this trip. But I had a dry pair of socks. Mind you, that was the only dry piece of clothing that I had. The last night we got there, I took out the one dry set of clothes that I had, and I said, I'm going to shower, I'm going to get clean, and I'm going to enjoy wearing some dry, clean clothes. That lasted until the rainstorm. Not only did I have dry clothes and a dry blanket, but I had a lot of excess water. Y'all ever carry around a gallon of water? It's kind of heavy, isn't it? It may not seem heavy when you pick it up, but if you carry it around for a while, it kind of weighs down on you. When you combine the extra water that I had that I never used and all the extra camping gear that I had that I never used, that stuff added up to a great amount of weight. Now, I don't know about you, but if you ever had to push excess weight, you ever had to paddle excess weight in the water, that kind of wears you out. It takes away your strength, even if you are in a nice boat. Ain't that right, Paul? All of this extra stuff that I was carrying was slowing me down. And I could begin to tell, because as I got through every day after paddling, I was tired. I've told some of you, that first night after we got through paddling, I had to sleep like this. Sorry, David. I could not put my arms down. Every time I tried to put my arms down, they'd come right back up like I was paddling. All of that extra stuff is things that I did not need, but they are things that I held on to. They are things that slowed me down when I could have been doing so much better. I had no need of these things. All they did was to impede me on my journey. You know, this week I was thinking about that, and it made me wonder, how many of us are carrying around things that we don't need? How many of us are carrying around things that are impeding us? Not necessarily in our day-to-day lives, but in our spiritual lives. How many of us are carrying around things that prevent God from doing what He wants to with our lives? Let's take a few minutes today and let's look at this piece of Scripture. This is a famous piece of Scripture. These Scriptures are Jesus Himself giving us the greatest commands in the world. What is the greatest command that Jesus gives us? Love God. Love God with all that you have. That's good advice, isn't it? That's going to come in another sermon later on down the road. I'm going to be nice to you today. I'm only going to preach one time this morning, okay? Let's take a few minutes and look at this second command. You shall love your neighbor as thyself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Now, can you argue with Jesus? You can, but like Joe says, you can argue with Jesus, but you're going to lose. Jesus is smarter than you. Jesus knows more than you do. And thank God, Jesus knows better than you do, right? But we still go on and argue with Him, don't we? We should not argue with Jesus, because Jesus knows best. And here, Jesus plainly states, you are to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Well, who is our neighbor? Do we remember that story from Bible school about who our neighbor is? The one who was abandoned on the side of the road? I'll let you in on a little secret. Our neighbor is the person that God loves. Now, who is that? Everyone. God calls on us to love everyone like we love ourselves. So that brings about the question of the day. How much do you love yourself? How much do you love yourself? I'm not going to stand before you today and pretend that we always do things and we're always pleased with what we do. I'm going to have to be realistic. There are times in our lives when we do things that we are not proud of, right? There are times that we do things in our lives that we may be ashamed of and we know are wrong. Am I correct in assuming that? We all fail. We all sin. Yes? Do you let these failures, do you let these sins continuously run your life? Do you continuously remind yourselves about your failings? Do you continuously live a life in the shadow of your failings? Or do you pick yourself up and move on? Do you forgive yourself and go about trying to do better? Do you allow God to forgive you when you fail? Do you? Okay, y'all, when we do this type of preaching, it really works when you respond back. Do you let God forgive you for what you have done? Y'all, it's not that hard. God plainly says that if you truly repent, He's going to forgive you. Are there any great hoops to jump through? Is there anything that we have to do aside being sorry and promising to do our best? God forgives us. Let's quote it again. When God forgives us, how far away does He throw the sins? As far as the east is from the west, and He what no more? Remembers no more. If you have asked God for forgiveness, has God forgiven you? If you have asked God for forgiveness, does He remember what you did? What about us? When someone commits a sin and truly asks for repentance, and between them and God, they get their life straight and God forgives them, do we forget the sins they have done? Jesus plainly tells us the second greatest commandment, the second thing that He wants us to know above all else, is that we are to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. And I'm here today to tell you that, Christian brother and sister, I think all too often we fail on that. We are too willing to forgive ourselves of the sins we have committed and not willing at all to forgive other people of sins that they have been forgiven for. When God forgives, God forgives. How many of you in here are greater than God? Yeah, I probably shouldn't raise your hand on that one. If God has forgiven someone, what right do we have to throw that back into someone's face? If God has forgotten about it, what right do we have to remind someone of their failure? Jesus addresses this point in the Gospel of Matthew. He says in Matthew, "For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." What does that say to us, dear Christian? If we don't forgive others, how can God forgive us? We too often take the pain and the suffering of others and use that for our own good. We fail to let someone move on from a mistake that they have made in their lives. Unfortunately, and I hate to say it, church has become the one place where someone who has fallen can't get back up on their feet. If someone does something wrong in the world and they make amends, the world gives them another chance. But how often does that second chance happen within these doors? We must be very careful, brother and sister. I don't know about you, but I am grateful for the grace God has extended me. I am grateful that God is willing to overlook my many, many shortcomings and to see who I can be and to see what He has for me as opposed to seeing what I have done. I wish we all could be a little bit more like that. For friends, I come back to this question. If God has forgiven someone, what right do you have to blame that person? If God has forgiven them, what right do you have to throw their sin in their face? Do you not take on the role of God Himself when you bring up someone else's sin in a condescending and bad way? Don't get me wrong. Scripture tells us that when a brother sins, we are supposed to go to that person and to lovingly and helpfully assist them in overcoming that sin. We are supposed to gather around and help each other. And that is well and good. But far too often when we see someone who is hurt, we concentrate not on helping them, but on deepening the hurt and pushing that knife in just a little bit more. I have said before and will say again, we must be a church that looks after its own. But far too often, we have been more concerned about what someone did in the past as opposed to what they can do in the future. Am I wrong? If God is willing to forgive and give someone a second chance, what right, as a creation of God, do I have to question that? What right do I have to question God Himself? I have told you many times before, the one sin that cannot be forgiven is blasphemy. And I'm not talking about saying the Lord's name in vain. I'm talking about when we take on the role of God ourselves. If we are unwilling to forgive, we are condemning someone, aren't we? But who are we really condemning? Are we condemning that person or are we condemning ourselves? We're condemning ourselves. Y'all, too many people are trying to cover the problems they have in their lives by pointing out problems in other people's lives. We are not ostriches. We cannot bury our head in the sand and expect things to pass over. If someone's attention is not on you, that does not give you the right to continue going on sinning and continue doing the things that you should not do. But far too often we think that. We think that as long as people's attention is focused somewhere else, no one will realize what we are doing. But who sees everything? God. Who is the only one that can judge us? God. Who are we to serve? God. I know this may sound like a strange message on the day that we celebrate the Lord's Supper, but I believe that when we come to this table, that our hearts and our souls need to be as pure as they can be. And brother and sister, I ask you this question. If you are still blaming someone for sins that God has forgiven, how pure can your soul be? If you are continuously holding a brother or sister down because of something that happened and something that has been forgiven, what kind of grace can God give you? We like to hold on to these things and we think that they're important and we think that they're valuable, but all they are doing is holding us back and holding us down. They are not helping. They are not uplifting. They are not building the church. Well, Pastor, it says in this book here that we're supposed to do so and so. Yeah. You know what else this book says? Love your neighbor as yourself. We will not be a church that picks certain verses. We will be a church that picks God's whole word and live by it. So friends, before we come to the time of the Lord's table, I have something to ask you. Before you partake in this, do you need to ask for forgiveness? Have you been bringing up someone's failures? Have you been bringing up someone's shortcomings? Have you refused to allow someone to grow in the grace and knowledge of God because you keep bringing up something that they have been forgiven for? We all need forgiveness. We've all done some things that we're not proud of. But the Christian asks for forgiveness and moves on. It is the people of the world that continuously throw our failures in our face. God wants to build you up, not tear you down. We must be people of God and not people of this world. Because I don't know what you're thinking, but tearing down people in this church is doing nothing for the kingdom of God. But building them up is building the kingdom itself. Amen? Today, before you come to this table, if you feel like you have done something to offend someone, if you feel like you have not, given someone a chance to bask in the grace that you rejoice in, if you feel like you have brought someone's past up, even though they have been forgiven, before we come to this table, I would ask that you would go to this person and seek forgiveness. Tell them that you are really willing to love them as you love yourself. And this is probably the most important part today. We must be willing to extend the same grace that God gives us to our brothers and sisters. For friends, Jesus says, "If ye forgive men not their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you." Do not take what we are about to do lightly. All too often we go to church and communion just happens. That is not what this is about. This is a celebration of Christ sacrificing Himself. Not because He wanted to, not because He was told to, but because He loved God and He loved us. Christ made this sacrifice because it was the only thing that could set us straight. And today, before we take part in it, I want to give you a chance to get your heart right and to confess if you need to. If you have taken someone's grace, if you have refused to forgive someone, you need to get right with that person. I pray that you would do it now. Reed's going to come up and he's going to lead us in a time of invitation. And this invitation, you've got several opportunities. If God has spoken to you and you need to forgive someone of something God has forgiven them for, I would encourage you to go during this time and seek forgiveness. If God has laid on your heart that you want to become a part of our fellowship, y'all, we are people that look out for each other. And part of that is encouraging each other to grow in our Christian walk. If you feel that God has led you to become part of this walk and to commit yourself to this church, now is the time to come and to make that public. But most importantly, if you need this grace that I speak of, if you need this forgiveness that I have spoken of, Jesus is here today and He is willing to speak with you and He is willing to forgive you if you would just come and admit that you need Him, and that only through Him will you find grace. I want to be standing down here. As we sing, if you need to come and talk, please come. As we sing, if there's somebody in this congregation you need to go and talk to, please take the opportunity to do so. May we heed the words of our Lord and Savior. May we love each other as we love ourselves. Read.
Let's all stand. Take a hymn book and turn to page 307.
here today to introduce, although they don't need introduction, Nina and Faith. Would y'all come up here and join me? Nina and Faith here have been worshiping with y'all longer than I've been here. But they have come to me saying they believe this is where God is calling them. They have been here, they have been serving, they have been dedicated. But today they come and want to make it official. They seek membership in the body of New Home Baptist Church. What is the pleasure of the church? Shall we accept these two sisters? I like this one a lot. She's fun. I would invite you. I don't know of another Baptist church where somebody joins the church and start throwing things at them. I would invite you after the Lord's Supper today. I'm going to ask Nina and Faith after the Lord's Supper to come back up here. And invite you today to come and shake their hands and welcome them into our family. These two are great servants already. I cannot wait to see what God is going to do with them next. So after the Lord's Supper, y'all make your way back up here. And everyone out there, please come forward and make them feel welcomed, okay? What was that last night like? That last meal that Jesus had with his closest friends. I've often wondered. I know Jesus was the Son of God. I know Jesus was amazing. But how can he so calmly sit, especially with the one who was going to betray him? How can he so calmly sit with these people that he knew were going to turn their back on him and run away at the first sign of trouble? God loves us even though we're full of faults. Amen? As Jesus gathered with his beloved disciples on that last night, I like to think that before the meal began, they had a great time of fellowship. It had been an amazing week. And as they sat there, Jesus and Judas were the only ones who knew what was about to happen. Jesus, knowing that his betrayer was there and that the time had come for him to make the ultimate sacrifice, he sat with his disciples and he tried one last time to teach them. Deacons, will you please come forward? As the meal wound down, and as they finished, Jesus, calling attention to himself, took a piece of bread. He offered this bread up to heaven, and he blessed it. Matt, will you please bless the bread? Jesus, after blessing, took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that will be broken for you." How much more meaningful that would be after the next few days, after Jesus was literally broken for the sins that you and I commit. As we eat, may we remember what was done for us. Scripture tells us, likewise, also the cup after supper Jesus took. He said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Christ gave all that he had. His very life, his very body, the blood that ran through him, he freely gave for us, us sinful, unthankful creatures. Yet he still loved us enough to sacrifice. Salvation. A price we could not pay. Thank you. Would you pray with me? Father, may we all one day be worthy of this sacrifice. Amen. The blood of Christ spilt for you. After the supper, Jesus and the 11 departed so that Jesus could go and pray. As we depart today, may we go forth from this place a changed people, a people that forgive, a people that celebrate grace, a people that practice grace. Please don't forget, I'm going to invite Nina and Faith back up here. Please come with open arms and welcome them into our fellowship. Don't forget, we'll be getting together again tonight for another message. I hope that you can make it out. Would you pray with me? Father God, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for overlooking everything that I have done. Thank you for loving me in spite of it all. Help me, dear Lord. Help us all this week. May we live a life that makes you proud, and may we give as much grace as we receive. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.